fantastic idea and thought, but implementation is going to take some time, prayer, and serious evaluation, because we want to be changing and evaluating on the move. Don't want to settle into anything. What do I mean? I mean, when you're now going to start using your Sunday morning services as an evangelistic tool, it is a huge, huge shift. Huge shift. So it's like there's a worship concert and then there's a Billy Graham convention. You know, a Billy Graham crusade. Now we're trying to put both of them together so that you're bringing the unevangelized, you're bringing the crowd that you want to share the gospel with, you're bringing them to Sunday morning where believers normally gather. It's a huge shift. So we don't want to just assume that, it's a great idea. It's a great idea, but it takes huge. I mean, people are going to be upset. Those who love their second row and their third row seats, they're going to come that some strangers have taken their seats. Because you're going to bring people, and people are going to come. And the church is going to start getting filled with all these. What happened? One person once told me, Pastor, what has happened to our church? I'm like, chips kala yaar chupta. I'm here trying to reach the city for Christ, and you're asking what has happened to our church? Because all of these people have come in and taken our seats, and on one day I found that same family sitting right at the back on the balcony. They were furious. So not everybody's going to be happy, including your board. They're not going to necessarily be happy, because the point of the matter is people are going to come in, the Punjabis will be talking to each other throughout the worship. The others will be doing something, then the children will be running out, they don't know how to behave. You know, all sorts of things. What are you going to do? How are you going to create, plan, design a worship service? I mean, you've got to be strict. There's got to be some planning. There's also got to be some margin. And your heart is going to have to get bigger. Your heart is going to have to get bigger. And you're going to have to get flexible. Your volunteers are going to have to get flexible. Your worship team has to get flexible. A lot has to change. So I want to think through that with you. Attracting a crowd for worship. Number three. Attracting a crowd for worship. Session number three. Preparing worship that witnesses to unbelievers. This is your service. This is about worship. This is for Jesus. It is not for the unbelievers. But if the unbelievers were to come, what do they take away? How do they see it? How do they feel? And why is it a great thing? Okay? How can we mix what Jesus was doing with what we do on Sunday morning? Many in the crowd put their faith in him. John 7:31. Many in the crowd. What was it? Was it the music? There was no music. Just thousands of people, and Jesus just spoke, and people got, they responded to him, put their faith in him. Let me give you some observations about crowds. Number one, Jesus' ministry attracted enormous crowds, multitudes. Now, we're not saying that every church and every pastor must attract thousands. Everyone has different personalities, different giftedness, different reach. It's there. But Jesus' ministry attracted enormous crowds and multitudes. So there's nothing wrong with big crowds. Oftentimes I've heard, seen Instagram, someplace, as soon as you see a big crowd, we get jealous. And we say there must be something wrong with the teaching. There must be something wrong with the pastor. He must be using some gimmicks. Must be the worship. Must be the girls. There's always some excuse for somebody else's success. Jesus' ministry attracted enormous crowds. It is legitimate. He met their needs. When they came, he fed them. Yes, no, hallelujah. He fed them. He healed them. He had compassion on them. He connected with them. Number two, he loved them. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. He saw the crowds as people needing a shepherd. Sheep needing the shepherd. I mean, when you go through Chandni Chowk, when you go through Sarojini Nagar, when you go through places that are crowded, Lajpat Nagar, metros, when you see those crowds, do you see them as an inconvenience? Or do you see them as, wow, what is Jesus thinking right now? The other day I was driving and I was like literally thinking this. And I was like, I literally feel like giving up my faith. That was what my outcome was. I literally feel like giving up my faith. God, how is it? Don't quote me on this, okay? Pastor Jerry said, "Come on, his faith is over." I was literally thinking, how can the teeming millions of Delhi be going to a Christless eternity? How can only one new person come to my church on Sunday, and throughout the week I'm driving through millions, and I'm considering all of them as an inconvenience? But a crowd there, there's too many people. India has too many people. We have to get used to that idea. I mean, we're just 29 million only in Delhi. 29 million. There are crowds. And if our strategy doesn't involve crowds, then our heart is not big enough. Don't say your room is not big enough. Don't say your money is not big enough. Don't say your influence is not big enough. Your heart is not big enough. My heart is not big enough. But what it brought out of me was anger. I got angry. And how millions and millions, what is God thinking that so many are going to go to a Christless eternity? What does he want me to do? How can I drive through these millions and just be okay with it? How can I get these people to come to church on Sunday? How can I get them to know of the love of God? Such were my thoughts. It didn't result in praise and worship. It resulted in anger, in frustration, in saying, "Lord," but it's basically this. The point is that God wants us to start with the crowds. And we need to think about how the Sunday morning service or how our weekend services can teach that. I love what Kelly said. Start another service. So we just started in Vasant Kunj. We started a Saturday evening service. Why? Because 4:30 to 5:30 people leave for work. Or 7 o'clock they leave for work. They work all of Saturday night. And on Sunday morning they go straight to sleep. So for them to come to church is very difficult. Some are working on Sundays now. And they just get allotted their work days. They don't get a choice in that. So our whole world has shifted. Our people have shifted. And you have to take what is weekend services or Sunday service and move it around to be able to get it to everybody. When you get it to them, Jesus went to the crowds. Jesus went, he didn't say Sunday market, I'll meet you there. He went daily. He went to the shores of Galilee. And so he met their needs. He loved them. He taught them in an interesting and practical way. This has to do with preaching. This has to do with preaching. He taught them. The large crowds listened to him with delight. Aajkal to so jaate hain. You know, there's hardly 40 people there and half of them are fast asleep. You know, not necessarily, but the point is that we are not half as interesting as the Lord Jesus himself. And he said it in interesting ways. So if you're going to draw big crowds, believers, unbelievers, new people, old people, different cults, how do you preach to order to keep them? Okay, so number one, Jesus attracted. Number two, a crowd is not a church. A crowd is not a church. So don't define the crowd as a church. A crowd is a large gathering. Bas, khatam. A crowd can become a church if you use the purpose-driven strategy. If you have a strategy and you go from biggest circle to smallest circle and you have moved people through those circles, then a crowd can become a church. A crowd can become a church. You can move them into a level of commitment. So no church grows without attracting visitors. That's what I was thinking when I was driving through Connaught Place the other day. There were hazaron log, millions of people. They are not going to ever come to my church if I don't invite them. If I invite them, they're going to visit. If they visit, will they stay? Will they stay in my church? That depends on how we set up the service. Is our service inviting? We're going to talk about that, right? So the worship, the Sunday service, needs to be designed in such a way that it allows for visitors, it keeps visitors, and gives them a desire to stick around. If you build your Sunday morning around believers, unbelievers will know they're not wanted. But if you build your service around welcoming unbelievers, that means the believers are thinking about others, both will feel welcome. Both will feel welcome. So no church grows without attracting visitors. I asked pastors, last 10 weeks, how many new people? Show me your cards. Show me how many new people came to your church in the last 10 weeks. Okay, last 1 year, how many new people came to your church? How many of your people naturally invite people to their church? And it's a good question to keep asking yourself. Number four, God wants his house full. What are we talking about? Observations about crowds. God likes crowds. God likes and wants everyone there. So we can't be gine chune, let's get the nice ones. Let's just get our own types. We have to be welcoming. Go into the highways and byways, hedges. Compel them to come so that my house may be filled. So Jesus taught both. He said, come and see, but he also said, go and tell. Come and see, go and tell. Jesus used both missional strategies. Okay, lastly, the first church in Jerusalem began as a mega church. The first church in Jerusalem began as a mega. On the first day, 3,000 men were saved. Okay? They didn't even bother counting women and children, because if one man is there, he's brought his family, oh, then you just can't double it. Alright, so the day 3,000 were baptized, added to the church. I want to go through this church Sunday morning experience. I want to look at our worship and see what are some convictions about worship that we are not going to change, and what are things we are willing to change. What do we want to rethink? Here are some things that you don't want to change. They are your convictions, and you can be comfortable that I'm not asking you to sit next to an unbeliever or another religion person and contextualize and water down your worship. Trust me on that one. Let's look at this. 12 convictions about worship. Number one, only believers can truly worship God. Amen? Amen. Yeah, we know that. We know that. That doesn't mean an unbeliever can't sit next to a believer and watch him worship, but only true believers can worship God. God is spirit, and only by the power of his spirit can people worship him as he really is. So the definition of worship is expressing my love to God for who he is and what he has done. If you don't know God, how are you going to worship? Only believers can truly worship. Number two, you don't need a building to worship God. Yes? Yeah, you don't need a building to worship God. The God who made the world and everything in it, and the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples built by hands. Okay, you don't need a building to worship God. Number three, there is no correct style of worship. There is only a correct spirit. There is no correct style of worship, only a correct spirit. Paul says there are varieties of services with the same Lord, there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them. True worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. The Father is looking for anyone who will worship him in that way, John 4:24. So there are no correct styles of worship. You can't look at one church and say, this is good, that's bad, this is correct, that's not genuine. What we're trying to say in essential is, you want to stand up and sing and shout loud and think, and these guys want to sit down quietly and they want to be more contemplative? There's no correct style. There's also no incorrect style. The spirit is, how do I express my worship to God? Are the people here telling God how amazing he is, so that the others who have just come may know that this is a great God? This is a great God we serve. So I think you know what that means. So let's move on. There's no correct style. Number four, unbelievers can watch believers worship. Agreed? Agreed? Unbelievers can watch believers worship. As they praised God, people in general liked what they saw, and every day their number grew as God added those who were saved. That's a loose version in the message here, but it's number four. Unbelievers can watch believers worship. So you really got to work through this, because I've done this. I've done it for years. I moved into this in around 2006 when people really started coming to church. And it actually became visible that we have a lot of new people on a Sunday morning. Today we average about 5 new people every Sunday. This is a new church plant. I just planted this church 3.5 years ago, the one I've just planted. And our gathering is only about 60, 70, 80. Sometimes we have a good day of about 100. But out of that, 5 is a solid amount. You know, there's 5, sometimes 10, we have new people. It's a solid amount. So we're constantly... And so you need to really think through how it feels for the unbeliever, how it feels for the believer. But believers must not feel robbed of their worship. We're not taking your worship service away. Pastor Jerry, what happened to our church? Nothing happened to your church. People are coming to see how nice it is. You know? So we want, unbelievers can watch believers worship. It's okay. Number five, worship is a powerful witness to unbelievers if God's presence is felt and the message is comprehensible. It's understandable. Worship is powerful. It's a powerful witness if God's presence is felt and the message is comprehensible. It's understandable. What do I mean by that? If the beauty of God's presence, the the holiness, the joy, the comfort, you know, the liberty. People can feel, even unbelievers can know that they have entered into the presence of God and others around them. And the second thing is, in the preaching, it makes sense. It makes sense. They can't disagree with you. They may not agree with you. They may not agree with you, but they can't say, I didn't understand what he was saying. Itna to you can make sense in English. So simplify it to the point and be normal in your language instead of, you know, hi-fi theological and biblical language and all that. Just simplify it so that anyone who comes can understand what you're saying. And he has a shot at agreeing or disagreeing with you. Agar samajh nahi aaya to kab kaun sa agree karega? You know? Then you say, no, you don't understand. You have to read the Bible. You have to study it. Then you will understand it. Then you can be. No. If he didn't understand the first time, he's not coming back. But if he walks in, he meets friendly people. He listens to beautiful worship that lifts him up, makes him feel the presence of God. And then he listens to a message that makes sense to his heart and is helpful for his week ahead. He's coming back. He's coming back. I'm telling you from experience, he's coming back. I'm telling you from faith, he's coming back. They need it. They want it. More people are hungry for God than you and I believe. My believers in my church are not, they don't believe that there are hungry people out there. They are the ones who are the unbelievers. They are the ones who are like, we don't want to push the limits. We don't want to feel like we're proselytizing or whatever the problem is. But there are hungry, hurting people. We've been saying this over and over again. Felt needs, meeting needs. Now this is another thing that has been debated in the gospel circles. It's been debated in the scholarly circles. That is it right or wrong to meet needs? And the point is, Jesus went about meeting needs. If you look at the fivefold ministry of Christ, if you look at the love and compassion of Jesus, he met needs. And many of them didn't believe in him. Many of them didn't come back to thank him. In fact, 9 out of 10 didn't come back to thank him. But Jesus met their needs anyway. Why? Because he's a need-meeting God. He's a need-meeting God. Ek bar, zindagi mein ek bar, at least let them come and meet the need-meeting God in your presence, in your church service. Uske baad, let them reject God, but you have done your part in allowing them to meet the need-meeting God. Wow! Worship is a powerful witness. If presence is felt and message is understandable. Number 6, God expects us to be sensitive to the fears, hang-ups and needs of unbelievers when they are present in our... There's nothing great about this. There is not. This is common sense. Koi mehman aa jaye tumhare ghar mein. Koi mehman aa jaye bahar se koi... You're sensitive to them, yaar. Would you like to sit here? Would you like to fan on karo? Fan off karo? Your AC on karo? You know, that's just basic. It's just love. It's just... You know, your typical Indian hospitality. We just think through that and say, okay, are you comfortable? Are you okay? You don't have to agree with me. You don't have to change your religion. But are you comfortable? At least your one visit to the church that you came, bade mushkil se ro pet ke, should have been a nice experience. You agree with me?
Yes.
Yeah. But in many of the cases, and I'm not judging here, I'm just making contrast for the sake of learning. In many cases, people come, straight gospel. Okay? And the whole feel is, all that time I felt like an outsider, I felt unwelcome, I felt like until I believe I won't belong, etc., etc., etc. And everybody felt like everybody was staring at me. How do we work around that? How can we change that experience is what we're talking about. Be wise in the way you act toward those who are not believers. Making good use of every opportunity when they are with you. Your speech should always be pleasant and interesting. Be tactful with those who are not believers. Okay, it's right there. Beautiful. 1 Corinthians 14. If the whole church comes together, everyone is speaking in tongues and some who do not understand or some unbelievers come in, what will they not say? These guys are out of their mind. They don't understand what's going on. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews, Greeks, Church of God. Right? You got the idea. Number 7. A worship service does not have to be shallow to be evangelistic. I repeat. A worship service does not have to be shallow to be evangelistic. The message does not have to be compromised to be understandable. Simple. Very simple. Nobody is saying you have to change your gospel, change your theology, not use the word Jesus. Nobody is saying that. You do what you have to do. But just like you invite people into your home and you become a little bit more hospitable, you tell the children, clean up the mess, you know, go inside, let them have the nice couch, give them the nice biscuits that were... The way you give your best, show your best, there's nothing wrong with that. In the same way, be wise with others when they come. So number seven, a worship service does not have to be shallow. You stick to your guns, just make it understandable. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in very practical ways. All right. Number eight, the needs of believers and unbelievers often overlap. Kamar mein dard hai, tumhara bhi kamar mein dard hai, unke bhi kamar mein dard hai. Both are having the same problem. Okay, unke bhi bachche hai, tumhare bhi bachche hai. Right? Most people have the same problems and they often overlap. So when we're preaching, teaching, when we're ministering, if we address these problems, if they address with solutions from the scriptures, even unbelievers will pick it up. Even unbelievers will pick it up. Let me give you an example. Right now we are working on a counseling ministry and developing a mental health and counseling ministry in our church. We're trying to get to where we are going to help our community with basic counseling, stress counseling, anxiety, marriage, this, that, children, loss of a child, loss of loved ones, etc., etc. And we find that in secular counseling, this is only an example, a secular counseling, they tell you what the problem is and they tell you what you need to do to get out of it. But in Christian counseling, they tell you what the problem is, they tell you what you need to do, and they tell you where to go to get the power to do that. We have the answer. We have the power. There is a place to go, the cross, where you can get the power. Nobody has it within themselves. Tab tak positive thinking, karte karte, I don't know how many people will be lost in the middle. You have the cross to go to so the needs of unbelievers and believers often overlap and they are different in some areas, but are very familiar. You can talk to some of my members of the church who are part of the conference here today. And when we preach and teach on Sunday morning, the believer understands the whole message just like the unbeliever does. He understands. And it's comprehensible. And then they are able to have conversations over that sermon because they understand it in a simple way. It didn't happen overnight. It took me years to try and rethink how everybody thinks and preach in a way that actually helps everybody understand the thing. So it's just love. It's just love adjustments, you know, but from love you just like, what can I do to make it better? How can I make them feel a little more comfortable? Of course, you first need to invite them. You need to make it convenient. You need to make them comfortable and you need to call them back. You need to help them keep the door open so that they come back. And we'll talk more about that soon. Number eight, needs of unbelievers. Number nine, it is best to purposefully target your services according to their purpose. So if it's a worship service, make it a worship service. If it's an evangelistic service, make it an evangelistic service. If it's a discipleship service, make it a discipleship service. Have one clear purpose. A lot of our churches have all the purposes in one. That's why the service goes for 3 hours. Announcements bhi karna hai, teaching bhi karna hai, evangelism bhi karna hai, offering bhi lena hai, worship bhi karna hai, everything. So there's 3 hour services because we're trying to get everything done. For years, I've been doing a 60-minute service. Only in the last one and a half years, because the people demanded it, we moved to 75 minutes. Only because they are like, no, we want more time for worship, we want more time. Yeah, then. So we moved it to, you know, we expanded a little bit. Because if Sunday is when you're trying to bring in the crowd and explain, remember, communicate the word of God, communicate the word. Church exists too. So if you're doing that and you know that discipleship is going to be in small groups, ministry is going to be in small groups, right? Peace is going to be in small groups, which is, and you got everything organized in the circles and everything's happening and everything doesn't have to be done on Sunday morning, you can relax and your service can be 1 hour. And if your service is going to be 1 hour, 15 minutes, more people will come. Because the first question they're going to ask, kitna? Oh, 3-4 hours, I'll wait for heaven. Of course I'm kidding, but you know, you need to think through some of that. Number nine, it is best to purposefully target your services to. This is important, please think about it. Like for instance at Saddleback, weekend services are planned for unbelievers. Night of worship is planned for believers. Small group is planned for intimate worship and discipleship. So you can decide what forums you're trying to hit what target. And remember concentration? Do you remember concentration? Laser, you could be more effective. I grew up in a church that tried to do everything on Sunday morning. Otherwise they're not available, yaar. They're not available. Monday to Saturday, they're not available. Sunday, some kuch karna hota hai. Because number 10, a service that witnesses to unbelievers is meant to supplement personal evangelism, not replace it. So just because you have an evangelistic service doesn't mean you don't share the gospel. Everybody should be sharing the gospel, but you also have an evangelistic service. Number 11, different kinds of services will reach different kinds of unbelievers. You can't have one stop shop for all. You've got to rethink all of that. You know what this means. You can take it forward. What really attracts unbelievers to a church is changed lives, not the service. Not the service. You can have the most amazing service, they're never coming back again. What they want to meet is somebody who got over what they are trying to get over. If they can find one character who loves them enough to help them get over what they're trying to get through, they will come back. It all boils down to relationships, before and after the service, and we need to think through that. Number 11. Number 12, it takes unselfish, I want to stop here and go slow. It takes unselfish, mature believers to offer an evangelistic worship service. For people to be willing to give up their comfort of Sunday morning and have strangers come in, it takes unselfish, mature believers. Every church faces this tension. Do we have a service or do we have a serve us? Is this a service or serve us? Paul says we haven't used our rights. In fact, we gave up our rights and we put it all on the line in order not to hinder the good news of Christ in any way. He says, your attitude must be like my own, for I, the Messiah, did not come to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for many. Okay, let's look at design. Okay, how to design an evangelistic service. Number one, plan it with your target in mind. Plan it with your target in mind. Who are you planning to invite? What are their needs? Are you planning to invite families? Okay, then who's going to come with the families? Children. What age is children? 6 months to 12 years. Do you have a plan for them? Do you have a place for them? What if the baby is a feeding baby, right? Teenagers. If people are going to come with cars, are you planning parking? You know, you can't have a service in the middle thing. Oh, gari waha park karke, you have to walk all the, you have to think through all of that. Now, this is also very American. And in Delhi, we do park it there only and come. And by the time we come back, the Lord has given the car to somebody else. Voluntarily. But we do need to think through that. Plan it with your target audience in mind. Number two, make it as easy as possible to attend. Make it as easy as possible to attend. Once upon a time, we had an 8 o'clock service in Noida Sector 137. We, 8 o'clock in the morning, Sector 137, Noida, in winter. It was just me and the spirit. You need to make it possible for people to attend. Alright, so how do I do that? Offer multiple services. Oh, then I'll have to preach 3 times. Preach. God will give you the strength. Multiple services and multiple sites. But we have our building. Choda yaar building. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Number two, offer surplus parking. Number three, offer children's classes at the same time as the service. Agar aayenge to bachche leke aayenge. Come on, are you going to look after the children? Are you going to take care of lunch? Are you going to call them so early in the morning? Are you going to call them late in the afternoon? Now they have to go home. Now they have to cook the sabji. You know, if you're going to have a service at 11:45, 11:30, then by the time they finish, have something to eat. Give them something to eat. At least it calms the nerves and the mother is not giving the father a hard time on the way home. Neither everybody's going straight to A to B. Straight to A to B. It's a South Indian restaurant. Which is like a second church service. Only with dosa. Number three, improve the pace and flow of your service. Come on, man. Come on. Don't keep those gaps. You know, those things we don't know what's going on. Okay, if it's only family, if it's only your church people, we know uncle is taking time to get up from his fifth row and make his way all the way to the front. Okay, and Jesus is calling him, he's coming. But when the unbelievers are sitting there, they don't know what's going on. They don't know what's going on. I was thinking the other day in our service on Sunday morning, we had some unbelievers sitting in the second row. And they were just all, you know, down, and everybody was down, so they were also down and all that. And they looked up, one fellow standing there in front with the bag. That guy got, she got the fright of her life. So, gaps, changes, no information about what are we doing next. Those, that kind of flow. So keep the pace, keep the flow of your service. Speed it up. There needs to be some energy, just some energy from the beginning to the end. Look for ways to save time. Okay, don't have announcements. When you have announcements, first of all, I guarantee you, from 27 years of ministry experience, nobody's listening. They're not listening to your announcement. But 7:30, even it's not 7:30 a.m., it's 7:30 p.m. Now, Badmi, you're explaining the whole thing. No, they're not listening. Print it, give it to them in writing. WhatsApp it. Instagram it. Do what you have to do to get it into the inbox and say, I've sent it to you. You can check it later. But right now, and announcements take up a lot of time. Announcements break the flow between the worship and the word. Okay? What the worship was supposed to do, you know, kodha the ground, get it all ready for the worship. Now everybody's like, heart is ready, one foot in heaven, you just all sorted and all that. And now he's talking about, you know, budget and this 24 lakhs and deficit and this and that, and that fellow is nothing, and these guys left the church. Okay, let us now look into God's word. Are you with me? It's just, there's no flow. We don't know what we're trying to do. So there needs to be this plan. Go straight from worship into the word, and let the pastor himself or the leader or the speaker himself kind of, okay, by the way, just before we get into God's word, a couple of family matters, don't forget this, don't forget this. Okay, let's go into God's word. You know, just keep it smooth, keep it moving. And even between worship or between the songs, too much. So just think through. Again, target audience. Target audience. If you have a uniform, homogeneous sort of a culture, and everybody already is like that, like the misos. Like the misos already know what needs to be done. Like they all know. They're chilled out. And there's no rush. And one by one, they know this is going to happen, that is going to happen. But when other people come in, they shouldn't feel confused. They shouldn't feel things. Then they'll act awkwardly. Then you look at them awkwardly. And then it all goes down south from there. Minimize the transition times. Keep pastoral prayers understandable and short. Pastor, please pray in private. So that you don't have to show in public how much you pray. If you prayed in private, maybe there won't be so much to pray for in public. But what are we talking about? We're talking about unbelievers, right? If unbelievers were sitting there and the whole church is like this and there's a long prayer, how would you feel if you were an unbeliever? How would you feel if you... You get what I'm saying? Is it wrong for to pray for long? No. But is that the situation? Is that the time? And how do you think through what they are thinking about? Okay, keep pastoral prayers understandable. We're not saying short, we're saying understandable. But even if they're short or long, think about it. Number four, focus on making visitors feel comfortable. Listen to this. In the first 12 minutes, even shorter I would say, but even the first 12 minutes, people have decided whether they'll come back or not. People have decided whether they'll come back or not. Long before the sermon, long before the songs, long before, in the first few minutes they came, sat down, they know whether they're coming back here or not. How come? Give me some ideas. Why?
These people are like me or they're not?
They've picked that up already. Number two?
Unwelcoming.
Similar?
Unfriendly.
Similar? Already you're picking that up. What else? Situation is not for me. It's too awkward or too strict or too quiet or too...
Not relevant.
Whatever. Or they make me go and sit right in front. Right in front. I've never come to church and here I am 1 foot away from the cross. So we take our guests to the back. And I'm saying when I say we do this, bade saalon ke baad mushkil se, after thinking and trying and, you know, we have learned these lessons. Okay, take them to the back. We play jazz music. As ungodly as that is, we play jazz music, chilled. Everybody, it calms everybody down. They do it in restaurants. They do it in other places. Huh? There's no incorrect style. Yeah. And it doesn't have any words, so, yeah. Over-welcoming, na? Yeah, कुछ ज़्यादा ही focus कर दिया इसमें.
हाँ.
Yeah, yeah. Then bring him up and saying and faltu mein you're just pointing at him, all that. That oh, we just think through that and make it. So first 12 minutes, you've decided. So you didn't think about that. What does that mean? We call it prime time. 12 minutes before. Let's make it 10 minutes. Okay, 12. Who's going to count to? It's 10. 10 minutes before and 10 minutes after. That's your prime time. Okay, pastor, friends, loved ones, strong ministry members. As soon as before the service, what are you doing? You're making them feel welcome. After the service, what are you doing? Go to your friend? No, go straight back to them. Hi, who's it? You want to leave? Okay, let me walk you out. And while you're walking out, don't whatever they want to do. You know, can I get you a cup of tea? Are you going to stick around? Can I get you a cup of tea? You got 5 minutes? Oh, yeah. You take one cup of tea, give them a cup of tea. Apne friend ko chodo, yaar, he's there. You've got his phone number. That is not the time to be going after. You get what I'm saying? So if you're thinking ministry-wise, you're thinking outreach, if you're going to call unbelievers, don't ignore them. Oh, it's so frustrating. When I see new people come, I'm not going to use the unbelievers, I say new people. When new people come, and well, they're just standing over there. You know, just look, somebody talk to me, or don't talk to me. They just, and all our people are seeing each other for the first time in their lives. Oh, they are so happy to see each other because 7 days have passed. Okay? And these guys, just, there's no focus on taking care of the new people. Right? Sometimes, not always happens, but sometimes. These are the kind of things we need to think through. It's funny, especially in our culture, but we need to look at it. Focus on making visitors feel comfortable. You never get a second chance to make a first impression. You never get a second chance to make a first impression. Your visitor's first emotion is usually fear. Your visitor's first emotion is usually fear. They're scared to be there, man. It's just out of their comfort zone. So the first goal is to help them to relax. Help them to relax. We're not judging you. We welcome you. We'd love to have you. So grateful you're here. Say it from the pulpit. Say it in person. Say it, okay? So here's a few ways to reduce the fear, visitors' fear and anxiety. You ready for this? Few ways to reduce visitors' fear and anxiety. Number one, reserve your best parking spots for visitors. Right outside the gate, right outside the church. Keep that for the new people. Yani ki all our, you know, our elders and deacons and bishops and you know, our popes and all that, they're like, they get all the best in front, and these guys had to park in Green Park Market and come walking. Yeah, give me, and best seats, best parking spots, think about that. Number two, station greeters outside your building. Start the party outside. Don't wait for them to come all the way through a depressing corridor, down through the stairs, into the thing, and then suddenly the joy of the Lord is your strength. Start the party outside, big smile. Please put people with smiles. Not those who have wrestled with the devil the whole week and now want to tell you about it, you know. Put two people and don't put two young girls. Not in our culture. Like, think like this. I mean, these are the things you need to think about. What does it look like? What does it feel like? Because we are so used to it. It's apna church hai yaar. Everybody's just fam. No. They are coming for the first time. And for every first timer, it is truly a first time. They have never seen this. They don't know where to go. They don't know where the toilets are. Okay, they're busting for the toilet. You are pushing them straight into the service. Mazak nahi kar raha main, it's real. So, give them, okay, brother, the toilets are up there. The children's thing is down here, you know, just here. So you've got greeters, then instruction, then seating. Greeters, instruction, seating. Depends on how far your gate is to the seat. But we call it gate to seat or street to seat. We call it that. And we have a ministry where everyone is reaching the people through that, walking them through that process. I'll talk about other things in the middle. What to look for in a greeter. Very important ministry this is. What to look for in a greeter. The qualifications of a greeter. Not greedy, greeter. Number one, people should project warmth. Not fire throwers, just project warmth. People who match your target group. Okay? So if you've got men walking in, don't have a young girl there. If you've got families walking in, don't have, you know, bachelors or singles or whatever. Yeah, kind of have kind of the same things. So I normally have like a couple, or we put two, an older lady, younger lady, and we shift and change that from the gate to the seat. So that you see somebody who's like you as you come in. When younger people are coming, kids, teenagers are coming, and they see only old people, you know, and it's like they're walking through a cemetery or something. That has also got its own issues. Yeah. Spread them out. Don't bunch them all up in one like they're going to, you know, gang up on you. You know how some greeters, char char khade wahan pe. Aa jaye. Chal jayega tu aaj. Yeah, bouncers. and have them say welcome back. At the end, you know, welcome back. It's nice to have you. Pastor Shanu once got introduced. Then he said, hey, lovely to have you at our church. He said, no, I'm the pastor here. So you need to put people who know who's there. Because we believe in getting people involved quickly. No? So some new people came. And they are introducing our own staff. Number four, have them say welcome back. Number three, set up an information table. Even outside, over here, see, over here we have a sample information table. And everything that you have that you can explain about your church is out there. Right. Number two, place directional signs. Where is the toilet? Where's the, you know, where's the children's thing, etc. Have music playing. When people enter, it relaxes people. Number six, allow visitors to remain anonymous in the service. Don't point them out. Just do a blanket statement. If you're here for the first time, lovely to have you. That's it. But let the greeters go personally. You know, you want to be acknowledged, but you don't want to be recognized. You want to be acknowledged, but you don't want to be recognized. You don't want everybody to know you're there. Some people are thinking through the faith. They're wondering whether, and Bade Mushkil said they have made their way to church. And then you go and announce on Instagram that they're there. You know, so, and even our media, social media, photo khich rahe, it's going all over the place. We need to be a little more sensitive to this sometimes. And we've got some very sensitive people coming to churches also, you know. We've got the Afghan community, we've got several others. You mean, just think through it. Number seven, offer outside seating if possible. Not like very far outside. Encourage everyone to fill out a welcome card. Welcome card. So we have this. Okay? Does it have it in your thing? Just look at the next page. Just flip over the page. I think it's there. Yeah, there it is. There it is. There's no page number, no? Yeah. So see, just I designed this along with my team so that you could just tell us a little bit about yourself, right? You can give us your bare information, DNA and stuff like that. And then feedback, how did you feel about the service? A prayer request, and each thing can be torn off. You can tear it off. And the part that you keep, actually has the information to the church. And you can pass that on to somebody else. This, the second part over here is an actual recommendation. You should go to this church. It's a really good church or whatever. You know, you really enjoyed it. If you're in Delhi or something, you can go. So we just do it like that, and we only go back with this much. So you're not wasting too much paper also. So we do that. So have cards, have stuff that use name tags. Use name tags. Say, can I help you? May I help you? You know, somebody help me, something like that. Offer a warm, casual, public welcome. Relax, begin and end each service with having people greet each other. Not necessarily in our culture. Not necessarily in our culture, but it depends on your group. Offer a refreshment table at each service. Kuch khane ke liye yaar, subah, before also, after also, cup of tea, cup of coffee, a little bit to eat, it does. Brighten up your environment, look at the building, lighting. Because when you get so used to your church, you begin to think, you know what, I know this. I'm used to this. It's okay. This is not working. Fan is not, it's okay. But, all right, 8 factors that create friendly environment. It's right there. I would like you to go through that on your own. It's a checklist just to help you plan yourself.